So good morning and welcome to this Sunday service for the 29th of August. We are not meeting in person at the moment, so we do pray you'll be blessed as you worship God from home. We begin with our call to worship. These words come from Psalm 33 from verses 20 to 22. We wait in hope for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. In him our hearts rejoice. For we trust in his holy name. May your unfailing love be with us, Lord, even as we put our hope in you. Amen. Let us sing together, How Great is Our God.
Splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. Trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God. Age to age,
And so we say together this prayer. Eternal God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, I come to you in worship. Father God, I praise you for my life and for all your wonderful creation. Thank you that you love the world so much that you gave your dearly loved Son to die for our salvation. Lord Jesus, like Thomas, I want to kneel and say, my Lord and my God. I praise you, exalted now and given the name above every name. Holy Spirit, I praise you for guiding me, helping me, interpreting the scriptures for me, and leading me into all truth. To God the Father who loves us and made us accepted in the Beloved. To God the Son who loves us and loosed us from our sins by his own blood. To God the Holy Spirit who loves us and pours the love of God into our hearts. To the one holy and immortal God be all honor and glory for time and for eternity. Amen. Our scripture readings for today's service come from Matthew chapter 10 and it's verses 1 to 11. Now I'm going to read it in two different versions. Firstly from the NIV and then from the Message paraphrase, which was written by Eugene Peterson. Jesus called his 12 disciples to him and gave them authority to drive out impure spirits and to heal every disease and sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, who is called Peter, and his brother Andrew. James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. Philip and Bartholomew. Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector. James, son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the Zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12, Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Do not go among the Gentiles or enter any town of the Samaritans. Go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. As you go, proclaim this message. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. Do not get any gold or silver or copper to take with you in your belts. No bag for the journey or extra shirt or sandals or a staff. For the worker is worth his keep. Whatever town or village you enter, search there for some worthy person and stay at their house until you leave. The same passage in the Message says this. The prayer was no sooner prayed than it was answered. Jesus called 12 of his followers and sent them into the ripe fields. He gave them power to kick out the evil spirits and to tenderly care for the bruised and hurt lives. This is the list of the 12 he sent. Simon, they called him Peter or Rock. Andrew, his brother. James, Zebedee's son. John, his brother. Philip, Bartholomew, Thomas, Matthew the taxman, James son of Alphaeus, Thaddeus, Simon the Canaanite, Judas Iscariot, who later turned on him. Jesus sent his 12 harvest hands out with this charge. Don't begin by traveling to some far-off place to convert unbelievers. And don't try to be dramatic by tackling some public enemy. Go to the lost, confused people right here in the neighborhood. Tell them that the kingdom is here. Bring health to the sick. Raise the dead. Touch the untouchables. Kick out the demons. You have been treated generously, so live generously. Don't think you have to put on a fundraising campaign before you start. You don't need a lot of equipment. You are the equipment. And all you need to keep that going is 3 meals a day. Travel light. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God for his word. I want to begin by asking you some questions. How do you think Jesus would live your life? How would he be a spouse to your partner? How would Jesus parent the children that you have? How would Jesus work at your place of employment? How would Jesus get involved in your community? How would he drive your car? How would he play in your hobbies? How would he spend your money? How would Jesus live your life? It's a great set of questions because it really helps us realize and see what's going on the inside of our lives, on how close to Jesus we are, on how Christ-like our lives are. And it's really important because ultimately that's what being a disciple of Jesus is all about, living your life in the way that Jesus would. In fact, that's inspired by a quote from the great Christian author Dallas Willard. He says this about discipleship. Discipleship is the process of becoming who Jesus would be if he were you. Discipleship is the process of becoming who Jesus would be if he were you. You see, that's what being a Christian is all about, living as Jesus would in your place. Now, this is important because Jesus, our Savior, is in the habit of sending his disciples out. He sends people out to do the work of God. In Matthew chapter 10, early in his ministry, he sends out the 12 disciples to do ministry for the kingdom of God. Now, Jesus does this by giving them great authority to kick out the demons, to heal the sick, to raise the dead, to spread God's love and light. It's impressive when we think about so much trust and responsibility being given to these disciples. But to be honest, I'm always more impressed with the disciples themselves who actually go out and attempt to do it, who actually attempt to go and live like Jesus. The scary part of this story is when we begin to realize that just as Jesus sent out those 12 disciples 2,000 years ago, he still sends his followers out today. The scary part is when we realize that we, me and you, are called to go out and make a difference as well. Jesus sends us out to change the world and to minister in his name. All of a sudden, we are less impressed with the disciples and perhaps more nervous and anxious for ourselves. I'm not sure I can do it. I don't know if I have that within me. I don't think I'm anything like one of those 12 disciples from the New Testament. I'm not a great Christian. I'm not an amazing man of faith. I don't think I'm good enough or skilled enough to actually go out and do the important work of God. I don't think I have what it takes. I wonder if you can relate to that way of thinking. I wonder if you've ever thought that way yourself. See, I think part of the reason for this is that we like to be prepared and to feel ready for any journey or any undertaking we are about to attempt. This was very real for me last weekend when I went to the Drakensberg Mountains for a dad's and daughter's hike with my Abigail. Now, that hike required us to be particularly well prepared for our journey. We had all the warm clothes we needed for the cold weekend. Jackets and raincoats and gloves and beanies and scarves and thick socks. We also had a gas cooker and pots to cook our food on. We had a big backpack with all kinds of straps and pockets to put everything inside. We had cutlery and crockery. We had enough food for the hike. We had a rolled up foam mattress, a warm enough sleeping bag, everything we needed to survive the trip. We even strapped a heavy tent to our backpack to sleep in the cold Berg night. We did that because you don't want to be caught in the mountains without the necessary equipment. That is scary, it is dangerous, and it will definitely ruin your fun. Now, for me, a really funny thing happened while we were packing to go on this trip to the Drakensberg. We had a WhatsApp group set up, and all the dads were speaking to each other on this WhatsApp group about getting ready for our adventure in the Drakensberg. And one of the members of our group sent this picture as a message to the group saying, "I'm packed, I've got everything I need for the weekend." All he needed for the weekend: an old pair of tackies, a Speedo, a sleeping bag, and a little bit of food. And while we can laugh and smile at his sense of humor, none of us, not even him, would dare to go on a hike of that magnitude so underdressed and underprepared. And in fact, it's like that for everything we do. We hate that feeling of not being resourced or equipped enough. We hate that feeling of being underprepared or underpowered for anything we face here on earth. And I feel that's one of the biggest stumbling blocks for Christians in us going out and ministering in the name of Christ. We feel underpowered, under-resourced, not good enough, or not equipped. I can't do that. I haven't prepared enough. I don't know what to say. I can't pray. I'm not equipped. I can't do it. When we feel that way, we don't go out and do the work of God. Now, unfortunately, that is simply not an option for us. We who follow Jesus are his disciples. We are his apprentices. We are people who are following his example. He is our role model, and we should be striving to be like him. Someone who goes out, who reaches out, who shows love, who makes a difference. And more than that, in our reading today from Matthew 10, we see that Jesus has always been in the habit of sending us followers out to extend the kingdom of God, to love others, to bring healing and wholeness. We are sent even if we feel unprepared and not ready to go. But I believe there are 3 points from this scripture reading that, if we look at in a new way, might help us get out of the gate and do this wonderful work that God calls us to. Be with Jesus on the journey of doing the work of the kingdom of God. And the first point is this, is that you are the equipment. You are the equipment. Now, this phrase comes from the Message's version of Matthew 10, verses 9 and 10. It says, "Don't think you have to put on a fundraising campaign before you start. You don't need a lot of equipment. You are the equipment." See, the way I read this, it tells us that preparedness for doing the work of God is not about having all the skills and training and fancy techniques that you need. It's not about having great church programs set in place for you to work within. The God we serve calls us to serve him as we are, to offer ourselves, our lives to him every single day. So you need to know this, that you are sent by God when you wake up in the morning and parent your kids. You are sent by God when you sit your spouse down and have that important conversation about your plans for the future, or when you sort out a niggling issue or something that needs to be solved, when you partner with him or her to get through a difficult thing you are facing. You go out and do work for Jesus whenever you treat someone with kindness or show compassion, when you stand up for what is right or act with integrity. You are sent by God when you do your best at your work, when you treat people fairly, when you make a difference or get involved or pitch up or do something with a positive impact. You see, you are the equipment God needs. Nothing extra, nothing fancy added in. Your everyday, ordinary life is already all the equipment God needs to make a difference here in this world. So go on. Go and live your ordinary life in service of our extraordinary King. You are already the equipment, and God wants you to work for him. The second point I want to make is in your neighborhood. When we think we are hearing God calling us to do some work for him, When we get a sense that God is sending us out, often our mind jumps to extremes. That must mean He wants to send me to China. That must mean I need to solve some great world crisis. I need to stop world hunger now. But in Matthew chapter 10, verse 5 and 6, Jesus says these words to His disciples. Don't begin by traveling to some far-off place to convert unbelievers. And don't try to be dramatic by tackling some public enemy. Go to the lost, confused people right here in the neighborhood. Tell them that the kingdom is here. I love that. Jesus starts off the disciples doing their work for God in their own community, to the people they already know in their own neighborhood. And Jesus says to them, make a difference there. That person you know who's going through a rough time, go and sit next to them. To that lonely man who needs a friend, go and be that friend. To the busy mom who is constantly rushing between her work and duties at home and making sure the kids are sorted out. To that mom who's struggling to keep her head above water, go and be her support, her help. Be there for that family in the stressful situation. Grieve with those who grieve. Mourn with those who mourn. Celebrate with those who celebrate. Your friends, your family, your neighbors, your community, the things and issues that surround you. Jesus sends you to them, to those people. And it isn't always that Jesus sends you to make everything better or take away their problems. Because let's be honest, most often we can't. We can't fix the problem or take away the pain. But we can point them to Jesus. We can remind them of His love. We can tell them that God has a plan for them, that God wants to help them, and that God is with them. We can pray for them, support them, and encourage them. We can invite them to church or send them this online service link. But the point is this, we've got to do something because no one is exempt from doing this work for God. We are all called to do kingdom work, and none of us are getting off not doing it. We have been sent, and we are called to make a difference in the places where we already are. And then the third point is, freely we have received, so freely we must give. Once again, in verse 8 from the message of Matthew chapter 10, we hear these words. Jesus says, you have been treated generously, so live generously. The point here is that we have all received generosity from God, so we now need to go and be generous in the way we live our lives. So we must love and reach out and show compassion and kindness. This is the way we live our lives for God, with a constant reminder that we have received so much from God already. We remember how good God has been to us. All the grace, the forgiveness, the help, the provisions, the protection, the guidance, all through your life, God has been generous to you. Generosity has been poured in from God. So now live a generous life in response to that. Now, when we speak about generosity, it's easy to make it just about material things or finances. But I'm not sure that's the generosity Jesus is speaking about here. He's speaking about a generosity of spirit, where we are constantly looking for avenues to share of ourselves and what we have for the benefit of others. We are generous when we share our insights and our wisdom, when we share our love or our compassion, when we give ourselves, our energy, our strength to make some noticeable difference, when we pass on our experiences, when we use our time for the benefit of someone else. Whenever we share of ourselves to make a positive impact for someone else, we are living generously. And that is quite simply a great way to summarize and simplify what God wants you to be. Know that you have generously received from God. Now freely live a generous life for others. So may you live with a generous spirit in all things. Because God always has been and will continue to be generous to you. You don't need to have it all together. You don't need to be fully prepared or some super Christian to get it right. It's not how God works. You can do something for Him. He sends you to make a difference. You are the equipment God has chosen to impact this world. Trust that He can work through you. Trust that He can even do some work in your neighborhood, your community, your family. Go and live generously. Freely you have received, now freely go and give. Amen. Let us pray. And so, Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for the reminder that we are called and sent by you to extend your kingdom, to share your love with this world around us. We thank you, Lord, that the job of being a disciple, a follower, is to live our lives the way that you would in our place. So we ask, Lord, that you would touch and transform our way of living. Help us to be more like you. Help us to serve you generously in our neighborhoods, understanding that we have something to offer the world around us. And so, Lord, for all the pain, the darkness, the frustration, the problems we see in this world, we ask that you would give us the courage to get up out of our seats and go and do something about it. To reach out to the lost, the lonely, the hurting, the poor, the weak. Help us, Lord, to think of ways and then to act on those thoughts as we reach out to the world around us. We pray, Lord, that we would always remember how generously you have treated us and that we would live our lives generously in response to all your grace. As always, Lord, we ask for your help, for the strength of your Holy Spirit, and for your inspiration in our lives. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And so, friends, we close off our service today by singing that well-known song, "Here I Am, Lord."
I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go. I will hold your people in my heart. I, the Lord of snow and rain, I have borne my people's pain. I have wept for love of them. They turn away. I will break their hearts of stone, give them hearts for love alone. I will speak my word to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord. if you lead me, I will hold your people in my heart. I, the Lord of wind and flame, I will tend the poor and lame. I will set a feast for them. My hand will save. Finest bread I will provide, till their hearts be satisfied. I will give my life to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go. I will hold your people in my heart. Oh, I will hold your people in my heart.
And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen. God bless.